Hello, I'm Jacob Krueger, and this is the Write Your Screenplay podcast. This week, we're going to be talking about Baby Reindeer, the hit new limited series on Netflix, written and created by and starring Richard Gadd. We're going to use Baby Reindeer to talk about how to adapt a true story into a limited series, into a feature film, or into a TV show. More importantly, we're going to be talking about how to adapt your true story. Because writing about yourself is potentially the hardest thing to do as a screenwriter. You would think that we would fully understand our own stories better than anybody's, but the truth is, you are the hardest person to write because you are the hardest person to see. You can see everybody else, but your own life is processed mostly internally, and that's the opposite of the way that screenplays work, right? Screenplays externalize those internal feelings. So we're going to be talking about how to get yourself on the page, how to tell your true story in whatever form you want to, and we're going to be looking at the structure of Baby Reindeer and how Richard Gadd does it in this fantastic little limited series. Before we get started, I do want to warn you, there are going to be some spoilers of Baby Reindeer ahead. So if you have not yet seen the show, I will warn you before we get to the big stuff, but I can't talk about it in an effective way without sharing some of the details of the script. Now, if you've listened to my podcast on beef, you've probably recognized that the structure of Baby Reindeer and the structure of beef are basically the same. They're both two-handers. Two-handers is a term from playwriting, where the idea is really driven by two main characters. They're both two-handers about two characters who, at any point, could end the escalation that's happening between them, but who keep making choices that drive the escalation forward. And the game of both of these limited series is basically the same. You keep giving Donnie, the Richard Gadd character, you keep giving him a way out. And you keep watching him not take it. In this way, Baby Reindeer is also kind of similar to Breaking Bad. You keep giving the character a way out, and you keep watching them not take it. Now, why would you construct a show this way? Why would you construct a movie this way? Why would you construct a limited series this way? Well, it's one of the profound ways to deal with the lies that your character is telling themselves. Every character lies to themselves. Every person lies to themselves. We don't lie to ourselves on purpose. We lie to ourselves because we have identities. We lie to ourselves because there are things that we don't want to look at. We lie to ourselves because we want to see ourselves in certain ways, right? We lie to ourselves because there are mythologies that have been foisted upon us since we were children that we've internalized and that change the way that we see ourselves and the world. There are all kinds of reasons that we lie to ourselves, but some characters' primary problem is that they are not being honest with themselves. If we look at, for example, Walter White in Breaking Bad, his primary problem is he's telling himself a story that he's trying to protect his family, that all this is for his family, that he's created a crystal meth empire just because he wants to leave something to his family. But since he keeps getting a way out, we can't help but start to realize maybe this is not just about his family. And it's not until we get to the final episode that Walter's actually going to be truthful with himself, which is, he loves it. He loves having power. This is not about his family. And so the structure is very simple. You allow all of his actions to keep hurting his family, to keep pulling him away from his family. You keep giving him the amount of money he needs to walk away. You keep giving him opportunities to run away. And what does that do? That forces his truth to the surface. And the game of the show becomes watching this person whose belief about himself does not match up with his actions. The same thing is true with Beef, of course. Both of the characters in Beef are telling themselves, I don't have a choice. She escalated. He escalated. I didn't want this. But They keep getting opportunities to make peace, and they keep on choosing not to do that. And their desire to stay in this beef belies what they are saying about themselves and what they are telling themselves about themselves. They both feel like the victim, but really they are both driving the story forward. And of course, this is also true in Baby Reindeer. In lesser hands, what would Baby Reindeer be? It would be a story of, can you believe this terrible thing happened to me? I am a victim. Don't you see what happened? I was a nice guy. This is where we start in Baby Reindeer. A nice bartender doing his job, and a sad woman comes in and sits at the bar, and she seems not be very well. She claims to have no money, but also to have all these incredibly powerful contacts as a lawyer. And Donnie, our main character, played by Richard Gadd, shows her an act of kindness. He buys her a cup of tea. And then she starts to come back again and again and again. And as the story unfolds, pretty soon Donnie ends up finding out that she is an all-out stalker. She has stalked a cop. She has harassed a man with a deaf son. She has gone to jail for this. She is the stalker of all stalkers, and she is after him. And so in lesser hands, Baby Reindeer would simply be a story about being victimized. But if you're writing a true story about yourself, and really if you're writing a story about any character, it is incredibly challenging to tell a victim story in a way that is compelling. Because a victim, by their own definition, is not driving their story. Rather, they are being acted upon by events out of their control. And there's a way to tell Baby Reindeer like this. Poor guy, shouldn't have bought her a cup of tea. And look what she did to him. Look how she destroyed his life. Look how she destroyed his relationships. Look how she set him on edge. Look how she pushed him to the extreme. We can do all that. But it's not going to be a particularly compelling story. Because when we come to watch a movie or a limited series or a TV show, we want to watch a character go on a journey. We want to watch them change or fail to change. We want to feel like they are moving under their own power, not just being acted upon by external forces. And this is particularly true when you want to adapt your own story, like Richard Gadd has done with Baby Reindeer. If you want to adapt your own story, you have to be willing to look incredibly deeply at yourself, even if you have been victimized. Even if terrible things have happened to you beyond your control, even if your life is a horror movie where monsters have come out of the closet and they are chasing you, you still have to ask yourself, how is the main character driving the action of their own story? How are they, I don't want to say deserving this, Donnie doesn't deserve Martha, but how are they allowing this? How are they inviting this? Or how are they failing to make the choices that push them through it? What is the lie that they have with themselves that they need to resolve? Or what is the problem in them that these external circumstances are coming into their lives in order to force them to confront? Now, I want to make sure that you're not overhearing me here. Sometimes in real life, a piano falls out of the sky and it happens to land on you. And you didn't invite the piano. You didn't step under the shadow. You didn't fail to look, right? You did nothing wrong. Sometimes the universe does victimize us. I'm not debating that. What I am saying, though, is that if you want to feel like you are rooting for yourself, and if you want to feel like you are moving, as opposed to being acted upon by forces outside of your control, or if you want to feel that way for a character, which is actually what makes us empathize and care about characters, You've got to tell more than the victim story. So even if you have been victimized, even if your character has been victimized, and if you've seen Baby Reindeer, there is no doubt about it. In so many ways, Donnie is victimized, not only by Martha, but also by Darian, the writer-director he so admires. He has been victimized, and we can guess maybe even during his childhood, there are ways he's been victimized, the way that his society deals with his complicated sexuality. There are so many ways that he has been treated wrongly and unfairly hurt. However, there's nothing Donnie can do about that. And there's nothing we can do about that when it happens to us. So if we want to tell a story of a character and feel like that character is driving their story, if we want to actually connect and root for, and if we want to actually draw these societal and interpersonal wrongs into the light, we have to figure out what choices is the character making in relation to the victimization. In other words, how are they still the main character, even though all these bad things are happening to them? One of the beautiful things that you can do in a limited series like Baby Reindeer is you can start an audience where they expect to be in episode one. And then you can slowly start to peel away the layers of the onion until we find more and more complexity. And that's the way that Baby Reindeer is constructed. We start out looking at Donnie very much the way that he looks at himself. We start off looking at Donnie as a victim. But by the end of the show, what we've actually seen is the pattern that Donnie is stuck in. The pattern of choices that he is stuck in that are actually driving the circumstances of his life. So this is the primary thing I want you to remember, and this is true in any story. We are not looking for characters that are acted upon by the universe. We are not looking for stories about characters who are victimized. We are looking for stories about characters who make choices in relation to the crap that happens to them. We are looking at the ways characters change or fail to change in relation to the crap that happens to them. In other words, we are always looking for journey. We are not looking for plot. This is incredibly important when it comes to writing your own true story. Because for so many of us, what draws us to write is that terrible, unfair things have happened to us. And we want to understand them and we want to write about them, but we are often angry about them. If a woman appears from the woodwork and you are kind to her and she stalks you and ruins your life, there's a good chance that you are coming to that script from a place of anger. Maybe you're writing a script about your failed relationship and you're so angry at your ex. You're so angry at what's happened. Maybe you're writing a story about a societal injustice and you're so angry about what happened. And the urge is to take the story outside of yourself and go, well, if this person would just be different, if these people would just be different, if our society would just be different, how wonderful would things be? And while there is value to that, it's very hard to get action out of that because we end up feeling like the character is sitting in place. They are not the author of their own story. So in order to tell your true story, you've got to look very closely at your truth. In a way, you have to be tougher on yourself than you are on the other characters. In a way, you need to develop a level of empathy for the people who have wronged you that maybe even exceeds what they deserve. You need to push yourself to look for humanity, even in people who seem mentally unwell or evil or terrifying or cruel. You need to find empathy for them and find a way to humanize them. And you need to push inside yourself to go, how was I wrong? How was I at fault? What poor choices did I make in relation to this? How do I need to change? What is the secret that I am keeping from myself, that these events, whether they're arbitrary or invited in, that these events are forcing me to look at. And that is going to be the center of your piece. At the center of Baby Reindeer is an incredible line from early in the relationship with Martha. Donnie admits to us in voiceover that there are things that he likes about Martha. Particularly, he likes the poetry of the way she speaks. And one of the examples that's given of her poetic way of speaking is these words. Some people run away by packing their bags. Others run away by standing in place too long. And I say that again because this is central to the theme of Baby Reindeer. Some people run away by packing their bags. Others run away by standing in one place too long. So this incredible little quote is actually an encapsulation of exactly what Donnie's problem is. He doesn't think he's running away. He thinks he's being kind, being brave, trying to make it as a comedian, dealing with these unfair obstacles in both his career and his personal life. He doesn't think he's running away, but he is. He is running away by standing in one place, by coming back again and again to the same unhealthy patterns, by failing to run after what he really wants, and instead coming back again and again to relationships that hurt him. In the second episode of Baby Reindeer, we will meet the woman that Donnie really loves, Terry, a beautiful, brilliant, transgendered therapist that he has a real connection to. And this is the next layer of the onion. So in episode one, we don't know he's having problems with his own sexuality. All we know about Donnie is that he tried to be nice and some terrible stuff happened to him. But in episode two, we start to peel back the layer of the onion and we start to realize, oh, Martha is not the only person who is lying about who she really is. I'm a lawyer. I don't have any money. I have all these incredible contacts. She's not the only person who's lying. That Donnie is also going into a relationship under false pretenses. In fact, he's even used a fake name, a fake profession, because he is ashamed. He is ashamed for reasons that we don't fully understand yet. We're kind of sticking him in a traditional genre of a closeted man who is trying to figure out his sexuality. Later, we're going to unpeel the layers of that onion too. But in this episode, what we're really seeing is a man falling in love with a person who is perfect for him. We are seeing a man falling in love with exactly the right person, who cannot choose her because of his shame about himself. And we're watching him start to choose the happiness of his stalker over his own happiness and over Terry's. We're watching him protect Martha. And as the show continues to an extreme, we're watching him protect Martha and not protect Terry, not protect the relationship. I'm going to give you some small spoilers here. Even at the moment where Martha attacks Terry physically, beats the crap out of her, pulls out a clump of her hair, and calls her a man, tells her she looks like a man. Even at that moment, Donnie does not go to the police. He lies to Terry, tells her that he did. He go to the police. this is an example of one of those ways out. When we first see Donnie, the very beginning of Baby Reindeer is Donnie going to the police and not being taken seriously because he doesn't have any evidence of her violence. And we'll assume that that's not the truth either. But this is evidence of her violence. This is exactly the evidence he needs to actually stop the stalking. And he chooses not to. And as a brilliant therapist, Terry puts her finger on it. She says, I think you love it. But Donnie is not at a place where he can accept that. He has a little lie that he's telling himself. The lie is that he's protecting Martha. The lie is that she's emotionally unwell. The lie is that he doesn't want to hurt her. The lie is that he's ashamed. The lie is he's overwhelmed. And there's another little lie too, which is in order to tell the police about Martha, he has to tell the police about Terry. In order to tell the police about Terry, he has to accept that he is in love with a transgendered woman. And that means accepting complicated things about his own sexuality. So you can see what's happening here. Yes, he is being stalked by a crazy woman. He is being put through hell. But the structure of the script is not him being put through hell. The structure of the script is him choosing Martha over Terry. The structure of the script is him choosing not to end the stalking. The story of the script is the secrets that the main character is keeping from himself. Now, there are going to be some major spoilers ahead because this continues. As the script continues, we're going to learn that Donnie is not only having trouble being honest about who he is with Terry, he's having trouble having a sex life with Terry. There are reasons for that that we're going to get into as we continue. And we're going to learn that as that starts to happen, that he starts to find himself drawn back to Martha, obsessing over Martha, masturbating to Martha. In fact, there's even a scene where he chooses to go have sex with Martha. And having sex with Martha frees him up to recover his sexuality with Terry. So you can see as each episode progresses, we're getting a different level of how complicated he is, how he is actually orchestrating the mess of his life, even though he is being victimized and forces are attacking him from outside of what we understand. As the piece continues, we're going to see an even more complicated side of this evolve because we're going to go back in time and we're going to see his relationship with Darian. Darian is a writer who's written a TV show that Donnie idolizes. He meets him at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival, where he is struggling to perform his act, and Darian comes in like the force of rescue that Donnie has been waiting for. Somebody who appreciates his talent, someone who recognizes who he is, somebody who sees him and wants to help his career. And just as Donnie is desperate for Martha's idolization of him, he is equally desperate for Darian's idolization of him. And Darian brings Donnie both to the light, bringing audience to his show, laughing at his jokes, helping him find his confidence, helping him hone his show, helping him be a better artist. But he also brings him into an incredibly dark place, abusing extreme drugs. And every time he gets really high, he will wake up and realize that there's been some kind of non-consensual sex happening while he's passed out. And he keeps coming back. So yes, he is being victimized by a terrible man in Darian. But the story is not the story of how Donnie is victimized. The story is the story about how Donnie keeps choosing to come back to Darian. He keeps coming back and he keeps coming back, even though things are happening he's not comfortable with. Even though he's aware that there's something sexual happening. He keeps coming back until it explodes into a violent and horrifying rape. And this adds the next layer of complexity. Because now we start to reconfigure all the story we've been telling ourselves. And this is the journey not only of Donnie the character, this is the journey of every writer as we try to look at our own true stories. As I said at the beginning of the podcast, your true story is actually the hardest story to tell because it's the hardest story to look at because you're looking at it through the blinders of the lies you're telling yourself. And often, just like the Donnie character, we tell a certain version and then we have to look under that version. Structurally, Baby Reindeer actually goes back in time to look under that version. And we start to realize that his questions about his sexuality began with this rape. We start to realize that he's not sure if he is gay or bisexual or attracted to men or attracted to transgender people, or if he is just so complicated trying to make sense out of what has happened to him that it has changed his sexuality forever. So we are launched into a different level of depth of understanding. And you can see structurally how this is evolving. We're not getting it all at once. We get a snapshot, something pretty close to what we'd expect, even though it pushes a little beyond. Then we get another snapshot and we go, oh, this is way more complicated than I thought. And then we get another snapshot going back in time that changes our understanding of everything that's happened up till now, that we start to realize, oh, this is a man who's kind to Martha, who's dealing with having been violently raped. Not only having been violently raped, but having allowed it to progress, coming back again and again because he wanted praise and he wanted a career, putting himself in a dangerous and more dangerous position. In other words, running away by staying in place. This is a story about a man who can't have a real relationship with the woman he loves, not just because he has a stalker that he's oddly fantasizing about, but because he is trying to make sense of the rape that has happened and who he really is and what his sexual preferences actually are and what is just an effect of the trauma. So we're watching this character and we're starting to understand all the different layers, again, not by how he was victimized. Yes, we see him being victimized, but by how he is orchestrating his own story, how he is running his own pattern, how he constantly is choosing to run away by standing in place.
If you're enjoying this podcast.
Now, the series feels like it culminates. And again, here's a major spoiler coming. The series feels like it culminates when Donnie finally tells the truth, when he finally tells the truth to himself. In a way, you can see, again, this is the same structure as Beef, right? And the same structure as Breaking Bad. In Beef, I won't spoil it for you, but listen to my Beef podcast. It culminates when these two characters actually look at the truth of themselves. In Breaking Bad, it culminates when he admits that he loves it. And in this show, it culminates when he finally tells the truth. He has been doing throughout the show a terrible comedy act. We have watched him do stupid gags and stupid jokes that are bombing throughout this show. And we're waiting. We're a smart audience. We're waiting for him to finally tell the truth in comedy and the audience laughs. But that's not what happens. What happens instead is that he has a total breakdown. The audience does not laugh, but he tells the truth. He tells the truth about being raped. He tells the truth about his sexuality. He tells the truth about Terry, and he tells the truth about his own secret. His own secret, which is that there was only one thing he loved more than Terry, which was hating himself. He tells the secret that keeps him in place. He tells us the secret that made room for Martha. His love for his own self-hatred. And we want to believe. We want to believe because we've seen so many movies where this leads to a happy ending. We are being set up for the happy ending, and we're even given a slice of the happy ending we're expecting. But Baby Reindeer is not about how we transcend our problems. Baby Reindeer is about how we find ways to keep running away by standing in place. Now, I'm not going to totally ruin the ending for you. No, I am. So at this point, I'm going to totally ruin the ending for you. By the end of Baby Reindeer, we have watched Donnie go back yet again to Darien. We've watched Donnie agree to take a job working for and with Darien. Darien promises it will be different this time. He's seen the video. He knows what happened. And Donnie chooses him again. And at the very end of the limited series, we watch Donnie go into a bar and sit down and order a drink in tears. And a kind, handsome bartender brings him the drink, and Donnie realizes he doesn't have his wallet. And the guy buys him a drink, and we fade out. This image is again part of the key to the secret of this piece and the way that the piece is constructed. The piece is not about looking at Martha and what made her a stalker. The piece is not about looking at Darien and what made him a rapist. The piece is not about looking at the many, many ways that Donnie has been victimized. The piece is looking at the stalker that lives inside of Donnie. Martha is just a blown up and turned up to a level 10 version of the needy piece in Donnie that keeps coming back, that cannot let go of toxic relationships for him. She is just an externalization of the needy thing inside of him, and that's what attracts him to her. She is just the part of him that is running by staying in one place too long. And this is the last piece that I want to talk about in relation to writing a script about yourself. Every character in your script, this is a concept from archetypes. Every character in your script is an archetype for some piece of you. People always say, write what you know. And then it's hard to connect that to this idea that, but there are these archetypal characters that are supposed to exist in your script. If you've read The Hero's Journey or Christopher Vogler's work, hold on, I'm supposed to write what I know, but I'm also supposed to write these archetypes. And the way you can think about archetypes is that every character in your life is an expression of some piece of you. So that when you write Martha, you're not actually writing Martha. You're writing the piece of you that's Martha. When you write Darien, you're not actually writing Darien, you're writing the piece of you that's Darien. When you write Terry, you're not actually writing Terry, you're writing the piece of you that is Terry, right? Because that's the only piece of these characters that you can actually know. That's actually how you write an archetype. The idea of an archetype is that archetypes are connected to the collective unconscious, that fabric that Jung talked about that ties us all together. Which means by accessing them, you don't go outside, you go inside. You go to the piece of them that you've internalized, and you try to figure out what that actual connection was that brought them into your life. You're trying to look for the piece of them in you, and that's what makes Baby Reindeer so fantastic. If Richard Gadd writes Baby Reindeer without looking at how am I like this, how are we connected? How do I have this need in me? Then Martha is just an unhuman creature ruining his life. But by allowing himself to actually look, that little sliver of him that wanted this, the little sliver of him that loved her, the little sliver of him that loved the praise and the affection that loved the compliments, that loved being the object of someone's obsession, the little piece of him that loved the drama, and the even bigger piece of him that hated himself. By understanding Donnie, we come to understand Martha. By understanding Donnie, we come to understand why this movie matters to me as the viewer, even if I've never been stalked. Because this is not a limited series about I got stalked by this crazy person and I got raped by this crazy person. This is about standing in place when you need to move forward. This is a limited series about running away by staying in one place too long. This is about failing to go after what you really want because of a failure to love yourself enough. This is a limited series about failing to cut the toxic people out of your life and instead coming back again and again and again. This is about the piece of us, of all of us, that is Martha. I hope you're enjoying this podcast and getting a lot out of it. If you'd like to study further with us, then come check out my free class every Thursday night with writing exercises and lectures connected to a community of fellow writers like you. It's free every Thursday night, 7 p.m. Eastern Time, 4 p.m. Pacific, online.